Good evening, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager here at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, these are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with Ottessa Moshfegh and Kim Fu. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and to the Seattle Times for their generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everybody in our community. I'd like to give a big hello and welcome to all of our attendees here at Central Library and also watching the live stream. I have just a couple announcements before we get started. If you're here with us in person tonight, our friends over at Elliott Bay Books have copies of both speakers' books at the table to your right. And if you're watching online, you will be able to find their books at Elliott Bay's website, elliottbaybook.com. And I'll drop direct links to the speakers' books in the chat during the program. And Ottessa is happy to sign your books after the event. We're requesting that folks be masked to stand in the personalization line just for everybody's safety. For folks here in person, if you need to exit the auditorium during the event, there's a door to your right. The building is officially closed, but the restrooms are open for the duration of the event. And after tonight's conversation, there'll be time for questions from the audience. Folks here in person can write your questions on the cards that you received when you came in, and staff will collect them toward the end of the event. And if you're watching online, you can type your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. I also wanted to let folks watching online know that we have closed captioning available. You just need to click the closed caption button or live transcript at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And for folks that are here in person, if you need closed captioning, we have a QR code that you can scan and it will take your smartphone to a web browser that will have the captions. We have those QR codes at this table behind me there. And finally, we're interested in hearing from you. Toward the close of the event, we'll be posting a link to a survey in the chat, and we'll collect the paper surveys as folks leave. We'd appreciate it if you all took a minute after the event to fill it out. Now, I'm delighted to welcome Rick Simonson from Elliott Bay Book Company, who will introduce tonight's speakers. Hey, Rick.
Thank you, Stesha, and thank you, everyone, for being here. Stesha's comments just now, sort of acknowledging that we're here, but also there online, help remind us of what things are, have become in the last 2 years. And that said, because Ottessa Moshfegh first came to Seattle as a writer in 2015, when her first full-length novel, Eileen, was being published, and which came after a short book from a smaller press called Magaloo. So it was not her first book, but the first book that kind of had a certain bigger publication. She's been to Seattle for every book since, except 2 years ago, literally this spring when Death in Her Hands was being published. We were sort of all set up in motion, and then everything that happened. And we weren't able to do anything with Death in Her Hands. So tonight, with this extraordinary book that she's here with, we're delighted to welcome her back, this new book being Lapvona, a book that has just come out and has certainly been going into readers' hands with great anticipation. And now I think, as I suspect some of you here tonight, here and there, will have read it. So that may add to the questions. Lapvona comes after Eileen. It comes after Homesick for Another World, a wonderful book of stories. It comes after My Year of Rest and Relaxation, and then Death in Her Hands. And Lapvona goes into different places in terms of its setting, its time, and the range of characters and the narrative voices. And you'll get to hear, I think, a little bit tonight. I think Ottessa will read a little bit, but in the conversation she has with Kim Fu, they'll draw out more of what this amazing and hard to describe, but you'll get the best people to describe it. We'll be doing so here with you tonight. It's a book deeply troubling in certain ways, and gives aspects of times and places we've read in other books, but comes at it with a very singular sensibility and narrative eye and voice. And that, again, will get drawn a little bit in when reading happens. When Ottessa said she would like to do this in conversation arrangement, Stesha and I, we thought of who in Seattle would be a good person for that to be. And we could think of no one more immediately than Kim Fu, herself, a highly regarded poet and novelist, more a fiction writer now than her first early work, a writer who has come to Seattle from Vancouver and other points on the other side of that border, but has written award-winning and highly nominated books, such as For Today, I'm a Boy, The Lost Girls of Camp Forevermore, and the recent extraordinary book of stories from Tin House, Lesser Known Monsters of the 21st Century. And Kim's also been a very generous person at playing this role with a number of other writers. It takes a real knack to do so. And we've at Elliott Bay, and I think here, have seen Kim do that, and online, Kim do that in the time of being online when these have happened. So they'll be up here, as Stesha said, they'll take questions on the cards, and Stesha will take the online questions. And then Ottessa will sign copies of her book. And we do have Kim's books as well. So definitely hope you will avail yourselves of those. The new book of stories has really been also going into people's hands. So on that, we thank you again for being here and for being online there. And I'll ask you to please join in welcoming an extraordinary and remarkable writer, Ottessa Moshfegh and Kim Fu. Thank you both.
I am so honored to be here with you to get to talk about Lapvona, a novel that the Washington Post called riotous, debauched, voracious, and biblically violent. And if that doesn't get you over the Elliott Bay Books table, I don't know what will. I would love if you would start off with a reading for us.
Absolutely. Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. I think I'm just going to read a couple pages from the opening so you can hear what the voice of the narrator sounds like and get a little bit of an idea of what the world of Lapvona feels like, and you'll meet a couple of the characters. The novel begins, it's sort of separated by season. So it begins in spring and it ends in spring a year later. So this is spring. The bandits came again on Easter. This time they slaughtered two men, three women, and two small children. Some smelting tools were stolen from the blacksmith, but no gold or silver, as there was none. One of the bandits was injured by an axe wielded by the slain children's mother. She smashed his left foot. Then he was restrained by neighbors and dragged to the village square, where he was beaten and put in the pillory. Villagers pelted him with mud and animal excrement until nightfall. Grigor, the dead children's grandfather, was too bereft to sleep. So he got up in the night, went to the square, cut off the bandit's ear with a garden knife, and flung it in a lemon tree laden with blossoms. "For the birds to eat," he yelled at the bleeding man and sobbed as he slunk away. Nobody could say what specific acts of horror this one pilloried bandit had committed. The rest of the bandits got away and took with them 6 geese, 4 goats, 6 wheels of cheese, and a cask of honey, in addition to the iron tools. No lambs were stolen, as the lamb herder, Jude, lived in a pasture several miles from the center of the village, and he had his lambs penned and sleeping soundly that night as usual. The pasture was at the foot of a hill, on top of which sat the large stone manor where William, Lapvona's lord and governor, resided. His guards were in position to defend him should any menacing individual ever climb the hill. Between the echoing screams from the village, Jude thought he could hear the gut strings of the guards' bows tighten from where he lay awake by the fire that night. It was not by chance that Jude and his son, Marek, lived in the pasture below the manor. William and Jude shared a blood relation, their great-grandfather. Jude thought of William as his cousin, though the two men had never met. On Monday, Marek, age 13, walked to the village to assist the men in digging a trench to bury the dead. He wanted to be helpful, but cowered when the bodies were laid out on the thick grass of the cemetery and the men took up their shovels. The heads of the dead were covered only in thin cloths. Marek imagined that their faces were still alive. He could see their eyelashes grazing the fabric as a soft wind blew. He saw the outlines of their lips and thought they were moving, speaking to him, warning him to get away. The children's bodies looked like wooden dolls, stiff and adorable. Marek crossed himself and retreated back to the road. The men of the village dug the trench easily without him anyway. Nobody cared that Marek had come and gone. He was like a stray dog that wandered in and out of the village. He was like a stray dog that wandered in and out of the village from time to time, and everybody knew he was a bastard. That's the first two pages.
I mean, while we're all reeling from that, I'd love to hear a little bit more about the genesis of this novel, and in particular, what drew you to the Middle Ages setting, or maybe away from a modern setting.
Right. Well, you know, weirdly, even though I think the setting, the place and the time is such a major element of the book, the genesis of the book for me began with Marek and what he does pretty early on in the book that sets the story in motion. Marek, we find out, is a very complicated 12-year-old boy. I don't really want to explain his character, but he does something violent accidentally on purpose that winds up being an incredibly big deal. And he eventually is taken in by William the Lord and is sort of adopted into this new situation. And I had started thinking about, spoiler alert, but not really, because it's kind of the premise of the book. Marek, okay, so I had this idea about one boy killing another boy, not in like some kind of fit of rage, but again, sort of accidentally on purpose, where there'd be reason to feel guilt and remorse and a feeling of responsibility for sure, but not like I'm a murderer and, I should be in prison. But like, okay, so one boy kills another boy. And for some reason, the family of that murdered boy decides that the best way to handle this is to take that boy in as a replacement son. And so I had that. And I had been kind of sitting on that like small premise, not knowing where it would lead, not knowing who these people were or the circumstances of this murder / accident. And I was like, maybe one day. And I wasn't planning on writing Lapvona. It happened, like a lot of things happened when the world shut down, basically. And I found myself in the situation where I knew I needed to write a novel,
both in response to what was going on and as a way to handle what was going on. And there was something very medieval about what was happening. I mean, I definitely thought of the Black Plague. I mean, I didn't want to write about that, but I'm sure that influenced my imagining of the setting. But I think I really committed to Lapvona, it's a fictional place, as this sort of non-specific region that might be in Eastern Europe, when I did a little bit of research into like some family lore about our ancestry. My mother is Croatian, and she would always say when one of us kids were, you know, complaining about some challenge that we felt ill-equipped to handle, or, you know, some weakness, you should say, don't forget, you came from pirates on the Adriatic. So I started researching pirates on the Adriatic, and that led me to researching the late Middle Ages. And I knew I didn't want to write another novel set on a boat, because that was my first book. So I thought about the land, and I just started designing Lapvona and thinking about its geography in its most basic aspects. Like, okay, having done some research, I know that the Lord's Manor is usually on a hill, because that's, you know, a safer place to be. And then I thought, okay, where would the farms be? Where would the people be? Where would the roads be? And where would they go to? And eventually I came to this world that was secluded, isolated in and of itself, which was important because I wanted the society of Lapvona to be caged in a way and complicated in its isolation, both in that it is being deprived of access to the outside world, and also sort of perverted by its own internal belief systems. Yeah.
You mentioned writing it to process a lot, like what was going on in the moment. And there is a lot about this book that sort of encourages us to read it like a parable and like an allegory. Like you say, like this setting being non-specific, the characters play with archetypes a little bit. You know, there is a local witch and healer. There is these, you know, this evil, corrupt, you know, depraved governor. And I was wondering what how you feel about this way of reading the novel, of like looking for sort of modern day parallels and analogs. Like, as an example, you know, Lord William, again, not to spoil anything, is not totally innocent in a year of terrible famine and drought
right.
The villagers experience. You know, to what degree are these kinds of parallels intentional, or do you think about them when you're writing, or do they just, you know, do you only notice them in retrospect? How do they factor into your creation?
Yeah, it's a good question, because it's sort of like the thing that I don't want to be thinking about when I'm writing. You know, like if you're, I think in the process of writing and you're thinking actively about allegory, then I know personally, like it wouldn't be an interesting book. So I had to kind of just forget that and let whatever was living in my mind just take the form of these characters. Because of what was happening, I was writing a book about a community, writing about someone who had all the power felt apropos, you know. But I also think like you can't really write about someone with that kind of power and it not feel satirical in a way, after what we've seen and been through.
Another way in which the book is kind of a, you know, not just the setting, but it feels different than a lot of your earlier works, especially specifically your novel length works, is you, I feel like you're known for your facility with the first person, with, you know, one character and a really specific voice and going really deep into their interiority. And, you know, Lapvona, as we just heard, has sort of a roving third person perspective that dips into a lot of characters, like at least a dozen, like a couple dozen, I think. And I was wondering, like, what drew you to that point of view, and you know, what was exciting about it? What was challenging about it?
What drew me to the point of view was that I definitely had shifted personally a point of view, thinking about the world in a more global way. And, you know, I've written several novels now that, oh my God, like that really take the form of almost like prose as like storytelling as like the monologue of a character. And I didn't want to just do that again. And that also felt like it would be really limiting and wouldn't allow me to tell the story that I wanted to tell, which was from many people's points of view and was a story about how one person's decision or impulse can affect somebody else's, and you know how somebody's delusion can impact a community. So it was necessary to kind of pull back and be able to see everything from a bird's eye view, and also have the ability to get really close up to each character and sort of go into them and hear their thoughts, and then leave and go somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, I was excited about the challenge, and I didn't really know what it was going to be like, but what I found, it was like incredibly liberating to be working with a different set of impulses that weren't attached to the impulses of one specific character.
But in a more general way, do you feel like, you know, looking back at it now, do you see Lapvona as of a piece with all of your other works, your short stories, your novels? Do you see it in conversation with them, or do you feel like it's much more of a leap? It's a big step forward in like your evolution as a writer.
I see them all kind of in, I mean, I kind of see each book as this, its own separate thing, but in hindsight, like I can look back and track like how my interests and curiosities developed over, you know, each project. And I don't know. I mean, this book used a lot of what I had found I loved about writing things in very specific non-contemporary worlds like McGlue. It also used a lot of what I found was really helpful in my year of rest and relaxation, thinking about like worlds beyond the human realm. In some ways, when I look back at the books, I think, oh, each book has just been a preparation for the next. But I wonder if you feel that way, or how do you feel?
I know some writers who like look back on their published works and all they can see is this like matrix of mistakes and things they wish they could change. And I don't feel like that. I would agree that I like being able to look back and see it as a little time capsule in a way. It's like, oh, that's the kind of writer I was. Those are the things that interested me. Those are the influences I can recognize.
Yeah.
I think that's helpful context, the way you just said too, because I'm sure a lot of people here tonight are coming as fans of yours, right? They're coming as people who know your other work, and you know, and I think hearing how the works relate to each other is always really interesting. The role of God is huge in this book, of the idea of a God and divine, as you were saying, like worlds beyond the human. It's, you know, it underpins a lot of characters' motivations and how they rationalize their desires and their actions to themselves and each other. And I was wondering if you could talk a bit about how you approach that aspect of it.
Oh, I've always wanted to be writing more. I feel like the way that I have developed in the last, 10 years as a writer is really to see the work that I'm doing when I'm doing it as it's a creative process. There's some amount of intellectualizing occasionally. But I feel the most passionate and charged when I see it as a spiritual process, almost a ritual. And I wanted to relate that into the book as well in a literal way. And also, it's not that I've been hiding in my previous works my interest in spirituality and how much I, as an individual, contemplate things like God, the idea of God, how the ideas of God have shifted, why and what does it mean to me and how do I feel about it and how impossible is it to put that into words. And it just felt like dearer and closer to my heart in this time. And I wanted to, explore it in fiction too.
Speaking of that personal connection, I heard in another interview you say that Marek was a little bit based on or loosely connected to yourself as an adolescent. And having read the book, I found that really, really interesting and really surprising. And I would love to hear more about that and maybe in comparison to how you created him versus how you created and how you relate to the other characters.
Mm-hmm. Well, I related to, Marek is if there's a central character in the book, it's Marek. And he, like I said, is the one that sets everything in motion. And at the beginning stages of a writing process, I feel like I still have some agency about the decisions I'm making about my characters. Very quickly, once I'm drafting, actually writing the novel, I feel like, okay, this is beyond me. I just have to get it right. And the novel's telling me what to do.
I feel that.
So I was like, Marek, what if I really tried to design a character whose physicality I could relate to? And my relationship to my body has been very much influenced by having scoliosis. I have diagnosed when I was 9, it was borderline, operable, but that would have been really complicated. I'm glad I didn't have a surgery, but I was in a back brace for 2 years, 23 hours a day at the very beginning of puberty. So it was going through a growth spurt, growing, in this way that was extremely uncomfortable, and also being confined and thinking about how, I was growing wrong. And it's something that is with me constantly every day. And I was like, how come I've never, it's the thing that is, I think, behind a lot of my interests in writing characters that are really embodied, talking about, the super magnified close-up internal, peculiarities of a character. That's all because I'm constantly, maybe this is just half of it, but I'm always aware of my body in a really specific way because I have chronic pain. And there is the sort of horror attached to that, horror and alienation. So I thought, okay, well, I'm going to make Marek kind of like me, but I'm going to push it to a worse extreme. And so once I saw him and I saw his vulnerabilities and how he sees himself as kind of a freak, and the way that he compensates for feeling, you know, inferior in that way is with this really kind of obnoxious sense of moral superiority. And I can't say that that was really my experience as an adolescent. I really wasn't, I don't even know if I had the capacity to have that sort of arrogance at that point. But the starting point of just like, how does a adolescent person deal with seeing who he's growing into?
The constancy of his physical experience. His physicality is definitely comes through, that it's like constantly on his mind, that it affects everything he does. That is 100% coming through in the book. This conversation makes me think about how there's this idea that goes in and out of fashion, I think, but is arguably pretty popular right now, that fiction is supposed to materially improve the reader and then therefore like materially improve the world. And you know, and therefore like fiction writers are supposed to be moral philosophers, moral arbiters in a certain way. Like it's not common to hear people say now, you know, it's like, I read a novel to become a better person. Mm-hmm. And there's discourse around all of your writing as like a direct rebuke to that idea. But as we're sitting here talking, like I'm thinking maybe it's more of a sideways way of approaching it, of that you are expressing moral ideas and amorality. And I was just wondering how, you know, how this conversation hits you, like when this conversation that happens around your work in general on that?
I always feel a little bit defensive. I, you know, my first thought is like, well, like, what are they watching on Netflix? Like that, like, why is it my responsibility to make sure like everything is okay? Everything is not okay. And yet everything is okay. Sort of. We're all sitting here. I mean, yeah, we're okay for this moment at least, but
at least the next 20 minutes.
Yeah. Knock on wood. Yes. I guess the whole like, yeah, I just think it's really insanely this idea that books or art in general should be for the betterment of an individual in a way that is sort of sanctioned by culture is to me like that, like we should have left that like half a century ago where it was. I mean, yeah, like we're lucky enough that we have the right to express ourselves in a way that isn't being controlled by the government. And, you know, I do not work in propaganda. Mm. I really think that like the way that we advance is by having new ideas, wrestling with them, and then coming up with our own opinions. So I don't know.
I mean, on that note, I mean, this question is kind of for my own benefit, but as we were talking about a little earlier, is I do some teaching and I have students who are big fans of yours, but find you a very like impossible writer to emulate. And I was just curious, like for other writers who are interested in writing about the grotesque, who are interested in, you know, people's base desires in the same way, like what advice do you give them?
I mean, I think a lot of it is just like being aware of one's own hangups. What do I not want people to see or know about me, and then writing into exactly that. And you know, it's not that we all need to hate ourselves in order to be interesting, but personality as it appears to others is essentially a performance. You know, I mean, okay, there are a lot of like things that we do unconsciously, but the way that we present ourselves to the world is not the person who we really are, because it's impossible to, I mean, to walk around that vulnerable and honest all the time. Like society wouldn't, I don't think like civilization would function. We'd be like, wait, I don't wanna do my job. Bye. Like, I wanna just like go have sex with her. Or I'm not gonna wait until lunchtime. So I think, maybe sort of digging into the primal feelings, and it's really easy to make it sound stupid. Like if you're like, okay, here's how I build a character. I think of five quirky characteristics, and then like I build a human being around that. Mm-hmm. Like I think actually has to be backwards. Like you imagine an entire human being, and then you imagine their relationship with themselves and what is really peculiar and unexpected about it.
Who are some of the writers that have inspired you that you have learned this from?
I don't know. I don't know.
Where do you think that this knowledge has come from? If it's been like, it sounds like it's been kind of hard won in a way. Like, what has been that process of how to access that primal? And
well, it's really how I learned to write, actually. That was like I had a teacher who became my mentor when I was a teenager, and like we were talking earlier about like writing education. Like I was never educated in craft or like structure or form and stuff. It was always about the voice and language. And you know, what makes a voice special and particular to the character who's speaking. Those are all like, it's all about the subtlety of how you construct your sentences. And you know, content sort of emerged for me like when I was like 32. Like I was a very aesthetic writer. Like I would write a voice in a story and nothing could happen. You know, it's just following somebody through not even a day. Like it wouldn't even be linear. It would just be someone talking. So that's kind of how I started. And this stuff, like writing things with plot and having a structure and thinking about it and all that stuff, that's still like very new and exciting.
But the plot is fascinating in this one, I will say. I was expecting someone to run up at me right about now with your questions on cars. How are we doing for time? Okay. But while we're waiting, I would love to talk about some of the other characters in Lapvona, in particular Ina,
mm-hmm.
Who is very fascinating, has quite an evolution across. I referred to her as a witch earlier, but that's perhaps not exactly accurate to how you conceive of her. I would love to know some of the inspiration around her.
Ina was one of those characters that, you know, sometimes people just visit you and they're sort of intimidating. And you know how like when someone is intimidating, you ascribe way more to them than you could actually really know. Like you just assume that there's this incredibly rich and deep past, and that that person's set of concerns is, you know, way more important than your own. Ina appeared to me a little bit like that, and I was scared of her. And so I felt this responsibility to like really get her down with as much as I could about what was fascinating about her to me. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I never really thought of her as a witch. I kind of don't like the word witch, but just has horrible connotations, but you know, she is in many ways immortal.
Mm-hmm. She is like the heart of a lot of the fantastical or like yes. occult elements of the book. So one of the questions that we've gotten from you guys is about humor. If you feel like you're like being funny is like a core part of the books you write and the voice in general.
Yeah. I mean, if I wasn't a writer, I would have been a failed stand-up comedian. Like, and yeah, I mean, I like humor. Comedy is, I mean, I really think comedy is the highest art form and the purest. I don't call myself a comedian, but I feel like what I do is like maybe 25% an attempt at stand-up.
I could see that.
Yeah.
I also feel like I don't know how you could write about, such, you know, the dark and the grotesque without any humor, right?
Yeah.
There are several people asking about something that you have read recently that affected you deeply in your favorite books, your favorite authors. There's a lot of that on these cards.
My goodness. This is always the hardest question for me because it makes me feel horrible that I don't read more. I'll just say the last book I read was I think classifies as a YA novel. And it was given to me by a friend who's adapting it for a film, and it's called Ruby Fruit Jungle.
Mm.
And it's sort of a coming of age story of a lesbian in the 60s. And it's really good. I thoroughly enjoyed it because it wasn't just like this a journey of this like incredibly strong person who loves who she loves. But it's also kind of a portrait of a time in which women were it's a portrait of someone really bucking the system against what society expected of women in a really entertaining way. So I enjoyed it.
Related to that, several people are also wondering about the choice to center Lapvona around a male character. And is that as a departure from you? Although McLew also had characters, but yeah, about sort of, I think the role of men in Lapvona and how that feels like a departure from some of your more recent work.
Yeah, I mean, I've written about men. I think it just so happens that like I wrote three novels in a row about a woman. I wanted to write about an entire village, and it was a village that included men and women. And the experiences of men and women in the late Middle Ages were very different in a lot of respects. I mean, surely they all shared a lot as well, but the roles, the gendered roles that people played in a society were very clear. And that seemed like an interesting opportunity as a fiction writer to kind of try to look beyond that and ascribe like contemporary consciousnesses to these characters that I think of as, or a time in which I, you know, it's very hard to imagine that people were just like us,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, to be honest, like I don't feel like I'm having a particularly female experience on Earth. Like it's not like the most forward descriptor. I mean, I do identify as female, but I feel just as different as Marek than I do Eileen. Yeah.
Were there online questions?
Yes, we have a couple questions from our online audience. McKenna asks, I love your work. Well, first McKenna says, I love your work. I read Eileen, My Year of Rest and Relaxation, and I'm now finishing Death in Her Hands. I'd love to know more about your approach to writing unreliable narrators who are still relatable in some ways. How do you balance showing their inner violence and cruelty while also not making them completely unsympathetic?
Was the word unreliable?
Yes.
Okay.
But not unsympathetic.
Okay. I mean, I guess in response, I would just say, like, I'm just trying to write the most interesting story. And what interests me about people are the ways that they are specifically themselves, not really what we all have in common. I mean, that's kind of like sort of take it for granted. And I have a lot of compassion for people who feel weird about being alive. So I don't really have to try to make them likable or unlikable. I'm just trying to make them feel distinctive.
I have two different people asking you to describe your daily writing ritual, your daily writing practice, like a day of work for you.
Well, it's really different. A day of work is very different if I'm writing a first draft, or even before that, I'm making notes and planning for a draft. And then, you know, once the draft is done, life is really different in the revision zones. When I'm making notes for a project, it's sort of like a lot of the practice is like tuning the dial to the right station. Like I write a lot in preparation, and a lot of it just disappears because it's not even writing, it's practicing. And it's like really trying to get into that frequency that is going to be the correct frequency for me as the author to be able to narrate, you know, not as me, but as this other storyteller voice, to narrate the story. So, and the way that looks like is like just kind of constantly being on the lookout and then writing as much as I can tolerate. When I feel that, you know, there comes a time where I'm like, okay, I think I'm ready because I can't wait anymore. And then I draft. And when I'm doing my first draft, I've at this point, like I am, and I think I would do this for my next book too. I write every day with a specific word count goal, rather than, okay, I'm gonna sit at my desk for 6 hours. You know, because sometimes, okay, if I want, usually it's 1,000 words a day. So if, you know, so that could happen in 20 minutes.
How?
I don't know. I mean, typing quickly, not thinking, knowing it automatically, kind of knowing it even before I'm gonna write it. Like, and a lot of writing for me, and this is true for revision too, has to do with like memorizing what I've written. Not that I could quote the entire book to you, but like if you misquoted a line, I'd be like, oh no, that's not correct. So drafting is like, it's a very tense time because I'm like, am I gonna be able to do it? Or is it gonna be like, what if I can't do it? And so I just force myself to do it. And sometimes it's sort of scattered throughout the day. And sometimes it's just, you know, I'm not getting up until I've done this. And then I really don't revise, recently on this book at least, I don't revise until I have a complete draft. And then the revision process is like, it takes, you know, 8 to 12 hours a day, because the longer you can stay inside a manuscript, the more continuity of thought you can maintain for a revision. It's kind of hard to explain, But if you're like picking something up and putting it down, picking something up and putting it down, you're gonna lose the thread a little bit. So revision is like an all day thing for months and months and months. Taking breaks between drafts for sure.
I asked a friend when I found out that I was going to be doing this gig. I said, "Do you have any questions for Ottessa Moshfegh?" And they said, "How does she write so fast?" And there, and yeah. I'm happy that I can provide her with an answer. Any other online questions?
Yeah, we have another question. This person chose to be anonymous, asking, "I'm wondering if you could comment on the role of substance abuse / addiction in depicting inner darkness of characters in your work, like Homesick for Another World and others." Think Euphoria on HBO, Breaking Bad, et cetera. Obviously, we're living in a time when there's lots of substance abuse and addiction, so that's very much a real factor. But I'm more curious about if there's an element of artistic choice in how you choose to depict this in your work and how you see it in other works. Sorry, this is not a very well-formed question. That's the person asking, not me.
Pretty well-formed question, I think. The role of addiction in my work. Well, if there are any addicts in Lapvona. I mean, there, I think
there's Tansy that
there, yeah, but it's not the addict isn't the addiction isn't front and center in Lapvona, whereas like it has been. Well, there's a lot of alcoholism, like in McGlue, it's really a portrait of an addict in a lot of ways. I mean, I think addiction, and this is me speaking solely as a writer, not as a normal person. Like I'm just like because what I'm gonna say sounds exploitative, but like addiction in a character is a very easy framework for designing their desire and their problem. And you know, so sometimes I think it's too easy. Like I think there are a lot, there's a lot of quote unquote content that sort of sees like addiction in one way. Those stories don't really stick. Whereas, I don't know. I mean, I find addiction fascinating. I identify as an addict. I'm a sober person and I still identify as an addict because I can get addicted to pretty much anything, including working. And I don't know. So I think for me, it's been just a way to very easily relate when a character is compulsive and trying to control and failing to control.
Yeah, I mean, obsession can drive character very easily. Yeah. And yeah, addiction is a clear form. I hear what you're saying about writers sound like terrible people when you think about, when you regard humanity in that way.
Yeah, like, oh, addiction is interesting.
Yeah, oh. How you can drive a plot.
Right.
There are a couple questions about your work creating aesthetics on TikTok, and if you are aware of this phenomenon, and if you how you feel it affects the perception of your work.
You know, I was made aware, but I am such an old fart that like I don't even know how to use TikTok.
That might be for the best.
So I remember seeing some TikToks about my year of rest and relaxation, but I don't really understand what's been happening or what the influence is there. But I'm just like, you know, if I've written a book that's getting people back into reading, that's fantastic. I feel so happy about that. And that's kind of as far as the TikTok thing goes.
That's a good answer.
Well, I have one question that was from the in-person audience, but it made its way to me, and I kind of love it. What do you like about your writing?
Nothing. What I like about my writing is that it is my purpose for being alive. I don't know if I would be alive if I hadn't found myself as a writer. And I think that something about that comes through. Like there, what I like about my writing is that it connects me to other people, and I can have relationships with readers through my work. In all, you know, in ways that I'm not even aware of, it makes me feel like I exist. Mm. It makes me feel like I have a place to not even archive my experiences, but somehow hold them. And I'm not a really emotive person in my daily life, like emotive or emotional. Like I tend to stay in a very sort of boring gray area emotionally. And I like that in my work, I access people who are, you know, sort of not even just people, just tonalities and feelings that are completely beyond me. It makes me believe that like creativity, creativity is an essential part of the human experience, and that it exists in order to expand consciousness and to communicate beyond, even beyond words. So that's what I like about writing.
They're communicating beyond words on TikTok too. Mm. That feels like a wonderful note to leave it on. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kim.
Here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you both. Yeah, let's give you a round of applause. Yeah. Thank you both so much. As we mentioned at the beginning, Elliot Bay have copies of both speakers' books at the table to your right. And if you're watching online, you can find their books at Elliot Bay's website, elliotbaybook.com. Ottessa is happy to sign books after the event. We're requesting that folks be masked to stand in the personalization line. And just as a quick note for folks that are here in the audience, we're going to sign at that white table. And if you can line up across the front of the auditorium, across toward this podium, that will make it smooth for everybody. And if you're heading out, please exit through the 4th Avenue lobby, which is behind me. You can drop your surveys in the basket on this table as you're heading out. And for folks watching at home, you can find the link for the survey in the chat, as well as copies of both speakers' books and at the library or Elliot Bay. We're so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thanks to our wonderful friends at Elliott Bay Book Company, and thanks to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to everybody who's watching and joining us tonight. We're so glad that you're here. We'll see you next time.